In late February 2024, TSMC held a ceremony in Japan celebrating the launch of its joint venture, Japan Advanced Semiconductor Manufacturing, or JASM. Founder Morris Dang gave a pleasant speech, and the Japanese government officially announced their support for a second phase. There are also swirling rumors of an even more advanced third phase. Meanwhile, the first phase of TSMC Arizona churns on. The size of its second phase remains subject to the size of the CHIPS Act subsidies allocated to it. Chips from that second phase are not expected until 2028, which I continue to deny is a real year, and not just 4 years away. JASM was announced in November 2021, over a year after TSMC announced Arizona back in May 2020. So in Japan, TSMC went from announcement to fab start in just 20 months. What is going on here? Why is TSMC doing better in Japan than in Arizona? In this video, we are diving into the question. TSMC's official comment is that the two builds are inherently incomparable. In other words, quote, "Stop talking about us and let us work," end quote. They're right, and I'm not trying to say that one culture or country is better than the other. Please keep that in mind. First, we need to appreciate the enormity of the task at hand. A semiconductor fabrication facility, or fab, is the ultimate expression of haste and unforgiving precision. Semiconductors are produced in dies embedded within wafers over the span of many months, using a sequence called the process flow. The process flow is made up of hundreds of process steps. Each step involves one of the major semiconductor functions: oxidation, deposition, photolithography, etch, ion implantation, or metallization, or cleaning. Never forget cleaning. To maximize the efficiency of the process flow, fabs are organized into bays, rooms filled with the equipment for completing a process step. This minimizes how far a work-in-progress wafer travels as it goes between each step. Altogether, the flow could involve up to 500 tools. They all go into a clean room, a room where no particles of a certain size can be allowed. Around the world, it takes on average about 1.9 years to finish a fab from construction to production start. TSMC tries to beat that. Now, I'm not a fan of social media in general, and I try not to go there. 'Tis a silly place. But I've seen Reddit comments claiming that TSMC is slow-walking the Arizona build because it wants to preserve Taiwan's quote-unquote silicon shield and keep the best nodes in Taiwan. The argument that TSMC is hobbling itself to play some geopolitical game is ridiculous. Just look at the economic incentives. A single fab over all of its phases might cost several tens of billions of dollars of capital investment. The company has publicly pledged $40 billion into the two Arizona phases. The fab tools rapidly depreciate and are only economically viable when they're being used virtually 100% of the time. So the company is burning money, and that is before you count lost revenue from not selling chips to customers. TSMC is a company owned by shareholders. They are highly economically incentivized to get those fabs in Arizona up and running. So please don't distribute these unimaginative conspiracy theories. First things first, the obvious stuff. Taiwan and Japan are very close to one another geographically. Kumamoto is on the Japanese island of Kyushu, about 1 or 2 hours away on a plane. Obviously, it's a whole lot better compared to a 12 to 14 hour flight to the United States. The distance delays responses to urgent questions, it means suppliers stretching themselves much further than they have ever done before, and so on. But there is nothing you can do about geographical distance. And there are multiple cases when Asian companies transplant their culture across the Pacific Ocean with little loss of efficiency, most famously the Japanese car companies like Toyota and Honda. Semiconductor companies have also proved it possible to build advanced fabs far from their home base. Intel famously has done so with Ireland and Israel, though the circumstances are not exactly the same. There's something else involved here. JASM runs a set of less sophisticated processes, a 28-22 nanometer technology, as well as a 16-12 nanometer FinFET node. Outgoing TSMC chairman Mark Liu said that the second Japan fab will use N6, a 7 nanometer class process node. Arizona, on the other hand, was an N5 node at the start, N5 corresponding to a 5-nanometer node. It was later upgraded to N4 technology. This is where I am legally obligated to remind you that the 5-nanometer, 4-nanometer, 3-nanometer terminologies are marketing terms chosen to indicate performance improvement. They are not indicative of the chip's physical parameters, and such parameters wouldn't tell you anything about final performance anyway. I feel like I shouldn't need to keep saying this, but I keep reading Hacker News comments asking what happens after 1-nanometer, so I will keep saying it. Anyway, my point here is that yes, TSMC Arizona runs a more sophisticated node at a smaller volume, but that is the whole issue. You start crawling and end running. TSMC is a conservative company. They would prefer to start with an easier node and work their way up the technology chain. With Japan, they're starting at N28, a common planar node, albeit with some tweaks to make it more suitable for image sensors. They then added FinFET with N16 when Denso joined in. And now with Toyota on the fun bus, they're going up to a semi-leading edge node with N6 with the second fab. And whenever the announcement comes out, that rumored third fab is likely going to roll out an N4 node or better. In the United States, TSMC going straight to N4 greatly ratcheted up the difficulty. N4 has more process steps than N28, and the tolerances are also way less forgiving. TSMC's former general counsel, Richard Thurston, touched on this in an interview with Taiwanese website Digitimes. American paranoia has caused an unusual focus on the most advanced process technologies rather than equally important legacy, something less than advanced technologies. Washington, D.C. became overly focused on pushing TSMC to build its most advanced processes and linked large subsidies to that process node. I understand the political pressure that these lawmakers were under to quote-unquote solve the chip shortage problem, but I do want to point out that many of the missing chips during that time were not made by leading-edge N4 nodes. One of the key things about JASM is that it was a joint venture. TSMC's other partners in the venture, Sony, auto parts maker Denso, and the car maker Toyota, don't hold much share in JASM. Right now, TSMC owns 86.5%, Sony 6%, Denso 5.5%, and Toyota 2%. And at first glance, it might not seem like much, but the partners' influences extend far beyond their shareholding. First, these three are not only investors, but also customers. They guarantee demand and volume, which is a huge deal in an industry where volumes mean so much. It allows you to raise yields and sell a lot of chips. Second, suppliers. In a prior video, I covered NUMMI, the Toyota-GM joint venture from back in 1983. One of the major reasons why Toyota wanted to do the joint venture was because General Motors promised to introduce its US-based suppliers to them. Sony is likely doing the same, introducing TSMC to its supplier network in Japan. At the start, many Taiwan suppliers still have to come over. JASM is only 25% locally sourced at the start, but the goal and intention is to raise that over time. And third, a Bloomberg news story points to the critical role that Sony played in facilitating TSMC's entrance into the local community at Kumamoto. They helped acquire the land and handle the fab's impact on the local area's water supplies. In Arizona, TSMC is working alone, with no local partner to help show them the ropes or smooth over misunderstandings. It is a monumental management and logistical challenge for TSMC, and especially its Taiwan-based suppliers, to come to the United States. It is no surprise to me that some of the local tensions and reports of unsafe behavior come at the supplier level. One Guardian story from August 2023 mentioned two such suppliers by name: United Integrated Services, Taiwan's leading clean room builder, and Marketech International Corp, a building maintenance provider. So why didn't TSMC set up Arizona with a local partner? One reason, I think, is that the best options would be something like GlobalFoundries or Intel. Both are fierce competitors. Another guess why is because the whole idea of a joint venture came from the Japanese government, who insisted at the start that Sony should be involved. They basically played matchmaker. TSMC generally doesn't do joint ventures, but this one has worked. The best indication of such is that they're using it again with their Germany fab in 2027. TSMC Dresden will boast Bosch, Infineon, and NXP as both customers/partners in getting that monumental fab off the ground. Maybe in the end, TSMC Arizona gets a joint venture partner to help straighten things out. Morris Dong and current CEO C.C. Wei used to work at Texas Instruments. Why not them? TSMC, along with Intel and Samsung, would not have started a build in the United States or Japan without financial subsidies. Subsidies in the semiconductor industry are expected. Everyone is doing it, including China, which is pumping in enough money to build a great pyramid over there. So let us set the philosophical ideas about subsidies aside. One of the major things about the CHIPS Act office versus the Japanese government has been the speed with which the subsidies have come out. Japan subsidized the first Kumamoto build with $3.5 billion, about 40% of the fab's total cost. The amount was announced in June 2022, just a few months after construction began in April 2022, with payments starting to be dispersed at 2022 end. As of this writing, the CHIPS Act office has yet to announce the larger subsidy amounts for TSMC, Intel, or all the others. It will probably be out by the time you watch this video, but the act was signed back in August 2022. Why has it taken so long? It probably has to do with the extensive vetting and planning by the CHIPS Act office. The office employs over 130 people, according to Bloomberg. You gotta staff up and prepare things. Free money always comes with strings, but the strings that the Japanese government attached to their money are looser than those attached by CHIPS. Nikkei reported that Japan's subsidy rules included a 10-year commitment, a requirement to increase output during shortages, safeguards for key technology, and continued investment in the factory. Note how localized these conditions are. They focus very much only on the Japanese fabs. The CHIPS Act, on the other hand, has instituted wide-ranging quote-unquote guardrails that are understandable. For instance, the expansion guardrails in China and Russia. Understandable, like I said, but they require review and more time to bring into compliance, especially for TSMC, which owns a few fabs on the mainland. Nobody wants the government to have to do a clawback. Labor. Kumamoto used to be one of Japan's major semiconductor manufacturing centers, but it has since fallen on harder times. The minimum wage in Kumamoto ranks as some of the lowest in Japan. 40% of its high school graduates leave to find work elsewhere. So TSMC was able to offer very competitive wages and build the fab faster. And yes, this is in thanks part to a weaker Japanese yen. Bloomberg quoted a senior director in Japan saying, "A job that normally earns 30,000 yen was paid 50,000 yen at the TSMC site." The same goes for engineers. The first Kumamoto fab is estimated to employ about 1,500 people. TSMC's engineer job adverts in Japan offer salaries that are a third higher than what the market previously could offer. Local companies are already complaining about TSMC vacuuming up their workers. This obviously is a big difference from the United States. Especially after many years of fab build inactivity, it is a much harder time recruiting semiconductor manufacturing workers at the prices people want to pay. Even Intel in Ohio is suffering a shortage, necessitating over 40% of their workers to be brought in from out of state. Taiwan and Japan also share similarities in terms of work cultures. Both emphasize long tenures at their employers. One downside of this is that it inculcates inefficient work practices, but on the other hand, it also gives workers the time to develop skills and mastery in their area. In Arizona, workers are a bit more fluid. TSMC asks that new workers do a training program in Taiwan for an extended period of time. I have heard that the dropout rate in that program is quite high. Nearby Intel has offered a compelling alternative for workers hopping over to higher wages and supposedly better working conditions. TSMC is going to be a recruiting bonanza for them until adjustments are made. And then there are the cultural clashes between the Asian and American workers. I grew up with Asian parents and relatives, and I love them, but their style is definitely an acquired taste. I don't think Americans appreciate repeatedly being called lazy. That should change. One notable situation comes to mind involving the local unions. Morris Dong is very clearly not a fan of unions, and the company he founded has gone a long way to avoid having them. when Chairman Mark Liu made an offhand comment at the earnings conference about bringing a specialized team of Taiwanese workers to the fab to install equipment, several Arizona unions publicly called out the company for misrepresentation and sought to block visas for those workers. One union leader published an op-ed accusing TSMC of trying to replace Americans with, quote, cheaper Taiwanese, end quote, endangering jobs and all that. This clearly caught the company off guard, and I think it's one of those situations where a local partner on the ground could have really helped smooth things over. The local government had to take up the slack. It's all just growing pains, and I do think TSMC and the labor force will eventually get things fixed to everyone's satisfaction. For instance, in December 2023, we got news of a deal between them and the unions. It all just won't happen as quickly as first thought. Regulations are a major issue to making sure the build happens on time. Take the example of when the Kaohsiung city government in Taiwan was courting TSMC to bring a fab to the city. One of the major issues was handling water supply for the thirsty fabs. The city's economic bureau set up a task force to coordinate with the company and started work on a new reclaimed water factory and pipelines for it. Notably, they cleared out all of the administrative procedures in a single day. The United States, on the other hand, is one of the slowest places in the world to build a fab. Americans have just not built enough of them. Fab builds have more than halved since the 1990s, from 55 to 22, and none of those 22 are large. These longer times are for several reasons. Material shortages, labor shortages, and transportation issues seem to be some of the larger contributors to these problems. But environmental permits like those for pollutants, discharge materials, asbestos, waste transport, stormwater pollution prevention, and more are also a source of delays. Different agencies handle this, making coordination and speed hard. And that's just the federal requirements, though local requirements tend to go faster depending on the location in question. I wouldn't try to build a fab in San Francisco, for instance. Imagine how many residents' view of the bay would be obscured. These regulations exist for a reason. Semiconductor critical raw materials are often toxic, dangerous, or carbon intensive. They aren't made in the United States and need to be transported in. The government will need to balance between its priorities for national security and environmental protection. I want to close with a few comments on the CHIPS Act. In the end, I believe the 2022 CHIPS Act will be seen as a public success, but it will be a qualified one. Furthermore, I think TSMC will play only a secondary role in that success. It's an election year in the United States, and Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo is setting out the key public talking points, like for instance moving America's share of leading-edge digital logic chips from 0% to 20%. I question the 0% number, by the way. What do you define as leading-edge? If you consider it to be a node at least three generations behind the leader, America's share of total capacity is probably more like 20 to 25%. Oh, and what about memory and trailing edge and so on? Anyway, much of that 20% would probably come from Intel, which to me looks more and more like the American national champion. Once 18A comes online at some large capacity, it will be a technological leader, and we can declare victory. As for TSMC Arizona, that fab will eventually make chips. Local news just reported that they added their last steel beam in February 2024. But as Mark Liu said, the future depends on the size of the subsidy. If TSMC wants 40% support, like with Japan on a $40 billion project, that is $16 billion in subsidies. Will the administration want the PR optics of giving $16 billion of taxpayer money to a foreign company in an election year? Maybe, maybe not. I should add that $16 billion doesn't have to come in the form of cash subsidy. The investment tax credits will do some heavy lifting as well. Anyways, so unless something changes, then, like with TSMC Washington / WaferTech many years before, that will largely be the end of it. No Phase 3. Instead, TSMC will expand into Japan, and I believe that will largely settle people's pearl clutching about Taiwanese chips, and we can all go on with our lives. Alright everyone, that's it for tonight. Thanks for watching. Subscribe to the channel, sign up for the Patreon, and I'll see you guys next time.